Good morning and welcome to New Hanover County Schools, The Morning Show. I'm Maggie Cottle.
And I'm Tori Farrell. This week of December 26th through January 1st,
it's the winter break and the holiday season, and our show today celebrates those and the new year.
We have a fun and interesting feature where we will take a look at different good luck traditions for the new year from all over the world.
And in our Student Voices segment, we visit the students at Freeman Elementary. They tell us what they would like to do in the new year and what they would like to change.
And we close our show today with a fun holiday trivia game that will test our knowledge and our wits.
It is going to be an excellent show, and we begin with a look at our morning news. Here's our anchor, Jimmy Barnes, with the morning's news headlines.
Good morning, Maggie and Tori, and welcome everyone to your school news here on The Morning Show. Topping the headlines this week, DC Virgo students build Lego Mindstorm robots, Winter Park teacher nominated for AIG Teacher of the Year, and do digital natives prefer paperback books to ebooks? I will have all these stories and more coming up later in the show.
Thanks, Jimmy.
Okay, get ready to laugh because it's time for our joke of the week.
Students in Ms. Clayton's honors drama class at Ashley High School have performed these jokes for the morning show.
Now you can start each day off with a dose of humor.
Here's our joke of the week.
A zookeeper is delivering some penguins to the zoo, but his truck breaks down in a desert outside of town. Luckily, a pickup truck soon comes by. The zookeeper flags down the pickup truck and asks, "Please take these penguins to the zoo." He then gives the driver $300. A couple of hours later, the zookeeper sees the same guy in a pickup truck driving in the opposite direction with the penguins still in the back. He shouts at the man, "You were supposed to take them to the zoo." The man replied, "I did, but we had some money left over, so now we're going to the movies."
Another hilarious joke. Thank you, Ashley Honors Drama.
And now it's time for a staple here on The Morning Show, This Week in History. Our Grandmaster of Historical Knowledge has all the headlines from past times in This Week in History, brought to you by Kidsville News.
Welcome to This Week in History. I'm your historical host, Rocco Solano, covering all the colorful and amazing events that have left their mark on history's timeline. This is the week of December 26th through January 1st. December 26th, 1966. The first day of Kwanzaa is celebrated in Los Angeles. The seven-day holiday, which has strong African roots, is designed as a celebration of African-American family, community, and culture. December 27th, 1932. Radio City Music Hall, a magnificent Art Deco theater in New York City, opens. It was designed as a place where ordinary people could see high-quality entertainment. Since its opening, more than 300 million people have visited. December 28, 1954. The Oscar-winning actor Denzel Washington, who will go on to star in such movies as Malcolm X and Training Day, is born in Mount Vermont, New York. In 2002, Washington became the first black man to win the Best Actor Academy Award since 1964. December 29, 1170. Archbishop Thomas Becket is murdered in the Canterbury Cathedral by four knights of King Henry II of England. The Christian world was shocked by Benedict's death, and in 1173, he was canonized a Catholic saint. December 30th, 1922. In post-revolutionary Russia, the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, or USSR, is established. Also known as the Soviet Union, the new communist state is the first country in the world to be based on a Marxist socialism. Finally, your weekend history tidbits. December 31st, 1999. The United States officially hands over control of the Panama Canal to Panama. The Panama Canal links the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans and is officially opened in 1914. January 1st, 45 BC. New Year's Day is celebrated on January 1st for the first time in history as the Julian calendar takes effect. Soon after becoming Roman dictator, Julius Caesar decides that the traditional Roman calendar was in dire need of reform. That's This Week in History, your ultimate source for those key moments in time. I'm Rocco Salerno. Thanks for stopping by.
This Week in History is brought to you by Kidsville News, a fun and effective learning resource for children, teachers, and parents. Kidsville News is always free. Copies are delivered every month to every elementary school in New Hanover County School System.
And join us again next time for another journey through time as we explore the fun, fascinating, entertaining, and educational facts that make up This Week in History.
We have plenty more of the morning show ahead, including Science Nation and this week's lunch menu.
Stay tuned, we'll be right back.
Oh, come on, Randy. Animal shelter, here I come. And no, I'm not crazy or emotionally damaged. That's a stereotype. I just belong to a total loser. I'm a good dog. So if you want a pet, adopt. And if you see Randy, tell him he dropped his wallet.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. I'm Maggie Cottle.
And I'm Tori Farrell.
The New Year is upon us, and people all across the globe are celebrating.
For many people, the New Year is also a time to change your luck, especially your bad luck.
And because of this, nearly every culture has formed a unique tradition to bring a person good luck for the New Year.
Today we have a special feature highlighting many of those traditions from many different countries.
So if you're looking for some good luck in 2017, you may want to try one of these traditions.
With New Year's upon us, here's a look at some of the good luck rituals from around the world. They are believed to bring good fortune and prosperity in the coming year. In Brazil, the Lenten is believed to signify wealth, so on the first day of the new year, they serve Lenten soup and Lenten and rice. Also in Brazil, on New Year's Eve, priestess of the local Macumba voodoo cult dress in blue skirts and white blouses for a ceremony dedicated to the goddess of war, Nemanja. A sacrificial boat laden with flowers, candles, and jewelry is pushed out to sea. In Denmark, it is a good sign to find your door heaped with a pile of broken dishes at New Year's. Old dishes are saved year-round to be thrown at friends' homes on New Year's Eve. Many broken dishes are a sign that you have many friends. New Year's Eve in Denmark is framed by two important broadcasts on television and radio. The monarch's New Year speech at 6 p.m. and the striking of midnight by the town hall clock in Copenhagen, which marks the start of the new year. In England, the British place their fortunes for the coming year in the hands of their first guests. They believe the first visitor each year should be a male and bearing gifts. Traditional gifts are coal for the fire, a loaf of bread for the table, and a drink for the master. For good luck, the guests should enter through the front door and leave through the back. Guests who are empty-handed or unwanted are not allowed to enter first. In Germany, people would drop molten lead into cold water and try to tell their future from the shape it made. A heart or a ring, and then a wedding. A ship, a journey, a pig, plenty of food in the year ahead. People would also leave a bit of every food eaten on New Year's Eve on their plate until midnight, as a way of ensuring a well-stocked cabinet. Carp was included as it was thought to bring wealth. In Wales, at the first toll of midnight, the back door is open and then shut to release the old year and lock out all of its bad luck. Then at the 12th stroke of the clock, the front door is opened and the new year is welcomed in with all of its luck. In Haiti, New Year's Day is a sign of the year to come. Haitians wear new clothing and exchange gifts in hope that it will bode well for the coming year. An old Sicilian tradition says good luck will come to those who eat lasagna on New Year's Day. But whoa, if you dine on macaroni or any other noodle, will bring bad luck. In Spain, when the clock strikes midnight, the Spanish eat 12 grapes, one with every toll of the clock, to bring good luck for the 12 months ahead. Even theater productions and movies are interrupted to carry out this custom. In Peru, the Peruvian New Year's custom is a spin of the Spanish tradition of eating 12 grapes at the turn of the year. But in Peru, a 13th grape must be eaten to ensure the good luck lasts. The Portuguese also eat 12 grapes from a bunch as the clock strikes 12 on New Year's Eve to ensure 12 happy months in the coming year. In addition, children go caroling from home to home and are given treats and coins. They sing old songs, which is said to bring good luck. In South Africa, they ring in the New Year with church bells ringing and gunshots being fired. For those in Cape Province, New Year's Day and Second New Year's Day are full of carnivals where people dress in colorful costumes and dance in the streets to the sound of drums. New Year in Pakistan is celebrated as a time of renewal. One of the customs is the practice of burning piles of wood. The bonfires are a symbol to destroy any remaining evil from the previous year. Norwegians make rice pudding at New Year's and hide one whole almond within it. Guaranteed wealth goes to the person whose servings holds the lucky almond. In China, front doors are traditionally painted red to bring in good omens. The Chinese also believe that dragons, fish, elephants, and cranes represent good luck and prosperity. Many people have statues or pictures of these animals in strategic parts of their house. And finally, the United States. Eating black-eyed peas and greens on New Year's Day will bring good luck and financial prosperity. The peas represent good luck and the greens represent money. And of course, kissing at midnight is a long-standing tradition. Kiss someone dear to you at midnight and it will ensure affection for the next 12 months. No matter where you are in the world this New Year's, be sure to ring it in with a good luck tradition. Who knows? It could make 2016 your year.
That was a great segment. I wonder if I tried all the traditions, how great my luck would be.
Who knows? You might be our next Powerball winner. If you are, be sure to remember your friends here at NHCS TV.
I will. It's time now to send it over to the news desk for more school news and our news anchor, Jimmy Barnes. Good morning, Jimmy.
Good morning, and welcome to your school news on the morning show. I'm Jimmy Barnes. Our top story this week, students at DC Virgo got to engage in science, technology, engineering, and math as they constructed and programmed Lego Mindstorm robots. With the help of the Cape Fear Museum mobile classroom, the students got to let their imagination soar. With a complete report is YSN reporter Bobby Blue.
It was an amazing opportunity for the students at Virgo to grow their creative problem-solving skills and enable them to become the critical thinkers and creators of the future. With the help of the Cape Fear Museum's educational outreach, students got to construct and program Lego Mindstorm robots.
The main components of this workshop is teaching the kids how to use the Lego coding software as well. It's requiring the kids to think in the same small, incremental steps that computer software engineers use. So not only are the kids being exposed to physical engineering, it's software engineering as well.
The Cape Fear Museum lessons provided an introduction to programming designed to teach core computer programming logic and reasoning skills using a robotics engineering context. During the course, students built their robots from scratch, and with hands-on instruction, they discovered how to give their robots life. Students discovered that data from sensors gives a robot information about its environment. A program uses that data to make decisions, and the robot acts on those decisions. Data underlines the core of the entire process.
It's been fun because like you get to build stuff out of Legos and program it to show you how it would. Like if you like take it into real life, it'll show you how they programs to do different things.
It's kind of hard to program because like you're not really in control of it, so it'll just like turn in random places when it's not supposed to.
Students worked in teams to master the concepts of robot programming. It was a crazy visual treat for those watching as little robots seemed to follow commands but then suddenly take wrong turns. The challenge to get the robots to follow a predetermined course encouraged the students to develop critical thinking skills, grow their ideas, and make their own creations through playful learning experiences. The skills learned through these lessons, mathematical and logical clarity, using data, systems thinking with mental models, and problem solving are not just for robotics, they are key to solving many problems in the world. Reporting for Your School News, this is Bobby Blue.
Tara Mulvey has been nominated as the 2016-2017 New Hanover County Schools Gifted Education Teacher of the Year. Ms. Mulvey is the Gifted Education Specialist at Winter Park Elementary School. The county's Teacher of the Gifted Award is presented annually to a North Carolina teacher who of gifted children who exhibits a strong commitment to the gifted education. Each nominee submits an essay elaborating on one aspect in gifted education that is important to them. Ms. Mulvey wrote about a topic close to her heart that dealt with nurturing the potential gifts in all students. Being at a Title I school, she is aware that students come to school with different experiences and abilities. She works closely with her staff to provide creative and critical thinking opportunities for all students. Ms. Mulvey will be nominated in January if she is a state finalist. She will also attend the North Carolina Association for Gifted and Talented 43rd Annual Conference in Winston-Salem, where the State Gifted Education Teacher of the Year will be announced. The new international school at Gregory's Watchdogs program welcomed District Attorney Ben David to speak to their group. Dads of Great Students is an innovative father involvement educational initiative of the National Center for Fathering. There are two primary goals of the Watchdogs program: to provide positive male role models for the students, demonstrating by their presence that education is important, and to provide extra sets of eyes and ears to enhance school security and reduce bullying. Mr. David talked to this group about crime in our city, the rise in gangs and drugs. He also shared a number of personal stories about the involvement with children in crime. Mr. David also commended the men for stepping up to be positive role models at the Title I magnet school. Watchdogs are fathers, grandfathers, uncles, and other father figures who volunteer for at least one day each year at an official watchdog school. During the day, watchdogs may read and work on flashcards with students, play at recess, eat lunch with students, watch the school entrances and hallways, assist with traffic flow and other assigned activities, where they actively engage with not only their own students, but other students as well. For all the latest on New Hanover County Schools, join us weekdays at 5:30 p.m. here on Time Warner Cable Channel 5 and Charter Cable 191. For Your School News, a complete half hour of all the latest news and information from New Hanover County Schools. Now back to our hosts.
Thanks, Jimmy. Those are some great things happening in our school system.
We're very excited now to introduce you to a new segment of Gardening and Nature Produce with the Cape Fear Garden Club and students from Myrtle Grove Middle School.
In this episode, our hosts tell us what it means to have a certified wildlife habitat.
Good morning and welcome to Gardening in Nature, brought to you by Cape Fear Garden Club. I am Barbara Downing and I am here with Megan and Emma from Myrtle Grove Middle School. Today we are going to explore what it means to have a certified wildlife habitat. Okay, Emma, what is the first requirement?
Provide food for wildlife like seeds from plants, berries, nectar, foliage, twigs, nuts, fruits, sap, pollen, and suet.
Great. Now, Megan, what is the second requirement?
Supply water for wildlife with a birdbath, lake, stream, seasonal pool, ocean, water, garden, pool, river, butterfly, puddling, area, rain garden, or spring.
Perfect. Now, Emma, what is the third requirement?
Create cover for wildlife with a wooden area, a bramble patch, round cover, rock pile, or wall, a cave, a roosting box, dense shrubs, or thicket, evergreen brush or log pile, burrows, a meadow, or prairie, or water, garden or pond.
Super. Finally, Megan, what is the fourth requirement?
give wildlife a place to raise their young with mature trees, a meadow, prairie, nesting boxes, wetland, a cave, host plants for caterpillars, dead trees or snags, dense shrubs, or a thicket, water, garden, pond, and burrows.
I know it sounds like a lot of requirements, but there are simple ways to make your garden wildlife habitable. Don't always rake away all the your leaves. Let your grass grow a little higher before mowing. Let flowers go to seed, and don't pick up all the pine cones. We can even construct simple cover with broken pieces of pottery, like the one that we have here in the studio.
Do we have any schools that have wildlife habitat certification?
Yes, recently, Bradley Creek Elementary received certification from the North Carolina Wildlife Federation as a result of efforts by the Gardening for Wildlife Committee of Cape Fear Garden Club. There will be a sign placed on the school grounds designating the school as a certified wildlife habitat.
Wow, that's impressive.
Our viewers also can learn more about wildlife habitats at their local library or online at host websites. That's a wrap for this edition of Gardening in Nature. On behalf of my co-hosts, Emma and Megan, thanks for watching. Join us next time as we explore winter gardens. Back to you.
Thank you, Ms. Downing, Emma, and Megan. That was a wonderful segment. We look forward to seeing many more.
Shifting gears now, we continue our show with Science Nation from the National Science Foundation. This feature takes a dynamic, entertaining look at research and the researchers that will change our lives.
From the latest inventions to studies that could change the way we perceive the world, each episode is packed with fascinating information.
No worries.
Chucker partridge, it's a quail type bird. Okay. Has it tremendous, powerful wings?
A lot of power, you can feel that.
From the day they're born, ground birds must scramble to get away from predators. Biologist Ken Dial analyzes in amazing detail the mechanics of their wing and leg movements.
Baby birds are striving to move to a safe place using their forelimbs and their hind limbs in any way they can. And with these little wings, they're able to accomplish very important behaviors. That is, to get to a safe place to live to see tomorrow.
That technique is called wing-assisted incline running. Many species use it to gain traction in a mad dash to get up and away.
Everyone we've ever looked at performs this behavior.
With support from the National Science Foundation, Dial and his team at the University of Montana Flight Lab use x-rays and high-speed video to understand the mechanics of bird flight.
We're trying to go from the skeleton to the muscles to the feather development.
They even go back in time.
We're trying to take the skeleton of fossils and bring it to life.
It's got an airspeed of 22 or so miles per hour.
At the lab's wind tunnel, biomechanist Brett Tobolsky blends biology and physics to measure the airflow patterns around this parakeet. Lasers and 1,000 frame a second views provide more insight.
The upstroke we're watching right now, sweeping down, you'll notice the feathers bending, loading up, turning around, very complicated motion.
Another practical application of the work we're doing is to understand how muscles perform.
That knowledge could be used to treat human muscle disorders or aid in designing safer aircraft.
Check all the flight surfaces.
Dial is an accomplished pilot, yet the power and flexibility of birds' wings still intrigue him.
The aha moments for me are usually when I'm piloting and I realize that I'm looking at 10 different gauges to allow me to fly nice and steady. And I'm just amazed at how a bird does the same thing.
Humans, he says, can only dream about some of their aerobatic maneuvers. For Science Nation, I'm Miles O'Brien.
That was another great segment from Science Nation.
It was. There are so many interesting science stories. I am glad we feature a new episode of Science Nation each week.
I look forward to seeing more.
All right, it's time for a quick break. Stay tuned, we'll be right back.
This is a man who almost learned to walk at a rehab center that almost got built by people who almost gave money. Almost gave. How good is almost giving? About as good as almost walking.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. Each month, we poll students on their thoughts from a host of questions. These questions range from local and national current events to topics that are just for fun. We feature their answers in a segment we call Student Voices. Since this is our holiday and New Year edition of The Morning Show, this week we asked students at Freeman Elementary School of Engineering, what is one thing you would like to do and one thing you would like to change in the new year? And here's what they had to say.
One thing I would like to change in the new year is to help others stop bullying. And one thing I would like to do in the new year is to learn new dances.
One thing I would like to do in the new year is learn more about history. One thing I would like to change in the new year is my handwriting.
One thing I would like to do in the New Year's, visit New York, stay in a hotel in sight, see Empire State Building, Statue of Liberty, Twin Towers. One thing I would like to change in the New Year's, the school's uniform policy.
One thing I would like to change in the New Year is to go to New York and Texas. One thing I would like to change in the New Year is that the teachers come with us.
One thing I would like to do in the New Year's is to work hard so I can complete my work. One thing I would like to change this New Year's is how I can control my anger.
One thing I would like to do in the New Year is spend time with my family and have fun. One thing in the New Year is to spend more time with my mama and my daddy and my brothers.
One thing I would like to do in the new year is more fitness activities, and one thing I would like to change in the new year is how the jobs work in the USA.
One thing I would like to do in the new year is to jog, and one thing I would like to change in the new year is my handwriting.
One thing I would like to do in the new year is donate food to the people that have children and whoever needs it. One thing I would like to change in the new year is hurtful weapons and drugs.
Thank you, Freeman Elementary and Principal Susan Sellers. Tori, how do you feel about the new year? Is there something you'd like to do or something you'd like to change?
I would like to get a job, so any viewers looking for any new workers, hit me up. What about you, Maggie?
I think I want to make a video that I take one video each day of the year and then put it all together at the end of the year so I can look back on it.
That's a good idea.
All right, at this point during our illustrious show, we usually bring you this week's lunch menu. However, since we have no school this week, we have a special segment of Food Facts.
In Food Facts, specialists from the New Hanover County Child Nutrition Office join us with important information for living healthy and happy lives. This week, Sarah Stevens shares important information with us about salt and salt intake.
So here it is, everything you need to know about salt. The truth about the delicious stuff that makes our food taste so good. Most Americans intake way too much salt. The Institute of Medicine advises the average person to limit salt to 1,500 to 2,300 milligrams per day. This amounts to a teaspoon or less. However, many of us ingest 3,500 milligrams or more each day. The sodium in salt does play an important role in the body, which is to conduct nerve impulses, maintain balance of water and minerals, and contract or relax the muscles. But all of these things can happen with just a small amount of salt. If we intake too much salt, we are putting ourselves at risk of developing high blood pressure, heart disease, and stroke. There are certain groups of people who are more at risk of developing health problems from overconsumption of salt. They are individuals over 50, those with elevated blood pressure, those with diabetes, and African Americans. These people should really keep their intake to 1,500 milligrams or below. So, let's take a look at how Americans are getting all of this salt in their diet. The most obvious sources are from frozen food entrees, any processed foods, lunch meats, canned soups, and cheeses. The processed foods can include fast food restaurants and even some sit-down restaurants. Some lesser-known ways you may be consuming too much salt are through already prepared pasta sauces, pizza, cereals, bread and rolls, cottage cheese, and ketchup. Let's look at some ways to lower our salt intake. Start cutting back on salt as early as you can. If a child is used to foods with lots of salt early in life, then it may be harder for them to cut back later on. At an early age, focus on ways to reduce salt. Increase your potassium intake. Potassium can help relax blood vessels, excrete sodium, and lower blood pressure. Eating lots of fresh fruits and vegetables is always a good way to ensure you are eating a well-balanced diet, and they are naturally high in potassium. Eat smaller portions. If you know the food you are about to eat is high in salt, such as olives or cheese and crackers, then just eat a handful. Cook at home. This way you know how much salt, if any, is being added to the food. You can substitute low or no sodium alternatives to your cooking. Cooking with different herbs and spices can add a variety of flavors. Some good ones are garlic, rosemary, sage, thyme, black pepper, and oregano. These spices also contain great antioxidants. Citrus juices and vinegar are great options as well. You should drain and rinse canned beans and vegetables before you use them in your cooking. This can help cut down on the sodium by 40%. Searing, sauteing, and roasting are great cooking methods that help to cut down on salt addition because they bring out the natural flavors in food. If you do go to a restaurant, you can ask about the sodium content of certain menu items. Remember your portion sizes and try to avoid menu items that have words like pickled, brined, teriyaki sauce, au jus, smoked, barbecued, soy sauce, or miso in the name. Remember, you are in control of your health. Now that you know the truth about salt and ways to decrease your intake, go out there and be the healthiest version of yourself. I'm Sarah Stevens, and this message has been brought to you by New Hanover County Schools Child Nutrition.
Thank you, Sarah. That was a lot of great information, and we hope it helps everyone start their new year off eating healthy.
We continue our show with tips on how to prevent holiday stress. While the holidays should be a time of relaxation, family, and friends, many of us know that that is not always the case.
Crowded stores, travel arrangements, cleaning for visitors, planning parties, cooking large meals, the list can go on, and for extra errands, and you have to complete during the holidays.
If holiday stress takes its toll on you each year, perhaps these tips will help.
During the holiday season, let these 8 tips guide your way to having a relaxing, low-stress time. First, be realistic. The holidays don't have to be perfect or just like last year. As families change and grow, traditions and rituals often change as well. Choose a few to hold on to and be open to creating new ones. For example, if your adult children can't come to your house, find new ways to celebrate together, such as sharing pictures, emails, or videos. Tip 2, stick to a budget. Before you go gift and food shopping, decide how much money you can afford to spend. Then stick to it. Don't try to buy happiness with an avalanche of gifts. 3, set aside differences. Try to accept family members and friends as they are, even if they don't live up to all your expectations. Set aside grievances until a more appropriate time for discussion. And be understanding if others get upset or distressed when something goes awry. Chances are they're feeling the effects of holiday stress and depression too. Tip 4, plan ahead. Set aside specific days for shopping, baking, visiting friends, and other activities. Plan your menus and then make your shopping list. That'll help you prevent last minute scrambling to buy forgotten ingredients. And make sure to line up help for party prep and cleanup. Tip 5, learn to say no. Saying yes when you should say no can leave you feeling resentful and overwhelmed. Friends and colleagues will understand if you can't participate in every project or activity. Our next tip, don't abandon healthy habits. Don't let the holidays become a free-for-all. Overindulgence only adds to your stress and guilt. Have a healthy snack before holiday parties so that you don't go overboard on sweets, cheese, or drinks. Continue to get plenty of sleep and physical activity. Tip 7, take a breather. Take some time for yourself. Spending just 15 minutes alone without distractions may refresh you enough to handle everything you need to do. Take a walk at night and stargaze. Listen to soothing music. Whatever it is, find something that reduces your stress. And our final tip, reach out. If stress does get to you, let others know. Talking to others is a great stress relief, and many times you will find comfort and help. If you really need to, talk to a doctor or a mental health professional. Don't let the holiday stress take over your life and enjoy the holidays.
We hope you take these tips to heart and have a peaceful and stress-free holiday season.
And don't forget, you can always relieve stress by relaxing as you watch our enjoyable programs on NHCS TV.
All right, everyone, get a pen and paper ready. It's time for our morning show math question. This is a challenging problem for you to solve at home. We'll give you the question now and then solve it for you after a break. So put on your thinking caps and get ready to solve our question, because here it is. Okay, we hope you got that down. Spend a minute working it out, and we will have the answer after this short break.
Stay tuned, we'll be right back.
Just buzzed.
You didn't tell us that, sir.
You're right. This isn't happening.
He'll be fine.
Yeah, I feel good.
Really?
No, not really.
Buzz driving. Maybe we should stop acting like it's no big deal.
Shock him.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. I'm Maggie Cottle.
And I'm Tori Farrell.
Before the break, we showed you our Morning Show math question.
Were you able to solve it correctly? Here is Elizabeth Crace, math teacher at Murray Middle School, with the solution.
Good morning. For our math question today, we have Taj. Taj had a piece of wood measuring 6 feet in length. If Taj cuts off 2 3/4 feet from his piece of wood, what is the length of piece remaining? So Taj had a 6 foot piece of wood, and he's going to cut off 2 3/4 piece of wood. And if I think about this, I'm going to subtract to find out this was my total in the beginning. Taj has cut off this much, so I want to know how much I have remaining. So I have two things I can do here. If I look, I can't just take 6 3/4 away from nothing. So I'm going to take this whole number and break it down to make it a fraction so that my math is a little bit easier. So I'm going to change. I'm going to take 1 away from 6 and make it a 5. But I still have this 1 hanging out here. So in order to make it a whole one, I'm going to look at this one and say that 1 equals 4/4. So now 6 is 5 4/4, and I'm going to subtract 2 3/4. Why I use 4 as my denominator is, in math, when we add and subtract fractions, we have to have a common denominator. So I was trying to make my work a little bit easier before I got started. So now I can take 3 away from 4 and I get 1. In math, we keep our denominators when we add and subtract, so my denominator is still 4, and 5 minus 2 is 3. So Taz still has 3 1/4 of his board left over. And now back to the studio.
We hope you enjoyed our morning show math problem and we got those brain juices flowing.
Each week we'll feature a new problem for you to solve.
It is time for NC Happenings. Everyone should get out their pen and paper as we take a trip across the state and look at all the events taking place in coming months.
Whether you're looking for an adventure or a relaxation, mountains or beaches, the rhythm of the city life, or the tranquility of nature, there is something happening for everyone here in North Carolina.
From January 6th to 8th in Fayetteville, the Nature Connects Art with Lego Bricks will happen. This exhibit features larger-than-life sculptures made with over 500,000 Legos. They represent the complex and amazing network that interconnects all living things on Earth. This exhibit is open from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m., and admission is $5 to $10. This exhibit will be moved after January 8th, so this is your last chance to check it out. For more information, you can call 910-486-0221 or go to capefearbg.org for all the details.
On January 13th through the 15th in Cary, the North Carolina Chinese Lantern Festival for 3 days, Cary's Booth Amphitheater will be transformed into a magnificent setting for Chinese Lantern Festival. The festival includes over 20 new displays, each one comprised of hundreds of parts and thousands of LED lights. The festival starts at 3 p.m. and ends at 9 p.m. Admission is $10 to $15. For more information, call 919-462-2025 or go to boothamphitheater.com.
In Raleigh, from January 13th to 15th, the exhibition for Art Deco cars from the 1930s and 40s will take place. The Art Deco period from the 1920s to the 1940s is known for blending modern decorative arts with luxury and glamour. This exhibition contains 14 automobiles and 3 motorcycles from the Art Deco era. It starts at 10 a.m. and ends at 9 p.m. Admission is $13 to $19. For more information, call 919-715-5293 or visit ncartmuseum.org.
On January 20th in Durham, Tim Hawkins Comedy Show will be there. Since 2002, Tim Hawkins has established himself as one of the great comedians of the country. With over 300 million video views online and over 100 sold-out concerts everywhere, every year, this family-friendly comedian is sure to have your family rolling on the floor laughing. Starting at 7 p.m. and ending at 9 p.m. and admission starting at $19, this show is not something you want to miss out on. For more information, call 919-680-2787 or go to dpacnc.com.
The Blowing Rock Winterfest will take place in Blowing Rock from January 26th to 29th. Don't hibernate, celebrate. Enjoy a fun side of winter with events that include the Polar Plunge in the Totola Lake, Winter Feast, Winter Paul's Dog Show, and many more exciting events. Event times range throughout the day. Admission varies from events, but is ranged between $5 and $27. For more information, call 828-295-7851 or visit blowingrockwinterfest.com.
If these events aren't enough for you or you're looking for something different to do, then check out website www.nhnc.com under the Upcoming Events tab. You'll be able to sort and search for something that suits your needs.
It's time for more Your School News, so let's send it back over to our news anchor, Jimmy Barnes.
Thank you, Maggie and Tori, and welcome everyone to Your School News here on The Morning Show. Do digital natives prefer paper books to e-books? Some experts predicted that e-books and digital devices would turn print books into relics, but that hasn't happened, at least not yet. With the report is Johan Yellow.
As digital devices and access to e-books boomed in schools and home over the past several years, some expected that print books would become relics, or at least fall out of favor with a generation growing up in an electronic world. But in a wrinkle in the digital revolution, that has not transpired, at least not yet. In fact, most students still opt to turn actual pages. In a survey, 65% of children ages 6 to 17 agreed they would always want to read in print. up from 60% in 2012. And 77% who have tried e-reading said that the majority of the books they read were in print. That was especially true for young readers when reading for pleasure. 84% of 6 to 8 year olds read mostly on paper compared to 62% of 15 to 17 year olds.
Students are gravitating a little bit more towards using the e-books just because of lack of familiarity. We have to keep reminding them that they're there. We kind of concentrate on nonfiction titles as opposed to fiction titles in the high school area to provide extra resources or sometimes duplicates of print versions that we have.
Meanwhile, ebooks haven't markedly altered the collections of school libraries. According to a 2015 School Library Journal survey, 56% of school librarians responded that they now make ebooks available to students, but that number was down from the previous year.
I'm using ebooks to teach nonfiction because I can show the whole class. It's easier to show them the photographs and all the text features on a big screen than trying to hold up a book. So I used one last week with third grade about the digestive system. I don't think I'm using them to their potential, but I also think that students enjoy holding a book and having the book in their hand. At this age, I think it's still very important to them and really creates a level of reading.
School librarians surveyed observed that while students use ebooks for school projects and research, many still prefer print books, especially for pleasure reading. Only 6% of librarians reported a high interest in ebooks from students, while 37% called it moderate and 50% said it was low.
I prefer like the feel of print books, but like ebooks are cheaper, so you get more. So that's kind of, I'll take any.
I usually prefer print books because you can feel it and you can get the sense of that nice, like that amazing feeling and texture. And ebooks, but like she said, is cheaper, so you can get a lot in the same price you can get a book.
I like print books best because I love the smell and the texture that you get from a book. It gives you a better idea of what you're reading, and it's so nice to like see the cover and how everything was designed and put together. However, I do really like ebooks in that I have a Nook and I can just throw it in my bag and take it to work, which is really convenient for what I do.
Studies point to a number of reasons why young people may prefer print to ebooks, including early familiarity with print books, the tactile experience of reading on paper, and possible advantages in comprehension, particularly for longer text. But as the School Library Journal points out, the next generation of students may add a whole new dimension to reading trends. The first smartphone natives are now just entering elementary school, and they may have a greater affinity for ebooks. Reporting for Your School News, this is Johan Yellow.
John T. Hoggard and High School Marching Vikings were winners of two big awards. Their first was the Grand Champions Award at Stallion Classic at South Columbus High School and the Brick Capital Classic at Lee County High School. All our high school marching bands compete in numerous sanctioned marching band competitions each year, in the hope of providing a broad-based opportunity for marching units to participate in an educational setting. It is hoped that the adjudication events will provide a situation in which viable comments and suggestions are offered in a positive, constructive manner to each group, and a fair evaluation of the group's performance is reflected within the event's rating plan. It is intended that the system provide the fairest, most consistent experience possible for all the marching bands. Congratulations to Hoggard for their honors. Finally, the Azalea Festival is running an art contest for elementary, middle, and high school students to express their creativity. The children's art contest is for elementary and middle school students. The winning artists in both the elementary and middle school categories receive various notable prizes, and the winning schools are treated to a visit from the Azalea Festival official artist. The top 15 entries in each category are exhibited during the Azalea Festival at the Community Arts Center in the historic Hannah Block USO building. The deadline for the art contest is January 15th. For more information, you can contact Stephanie Craybill at stephanie@craybill.org or call 910-620-7083 with questions. That's all for now. To watch this week's edition of Your School News online, visit the school system's website at www.nhcs.net and click on the NHCS TV logo on the homepage. Now back over to Maggie and Tori.
Thanks, Jimmy. Now to end today's show, we will play a fun holiday game called the Christmas Challenge.
This exciting game will test our knowledge from movies to traditions to songs, and you at home can play along too.
Let's send it back over to Jimmy, who has all the game rules. Welcome back, Jimmy.
Thank you. Today we have a festive holiday challenge. I will ask a trivia question. If you think you know the answer, you must buzz. The first person to buzz gets to answer. If you blurt out an answer without buzzing or winning the buzz, it will not count. If you hit your buzzer before I finish reading, I will stop until you answer. If you get a question wrong, your counterpart will have a chance to answer it. Finally, if you are both stumped on one, I will give the answer and we will move on. Also, two-thirds of the way through, the questions will change to a new challenge, so be prepared. Okay, contestants, are you ready?
Born ready.
Yeah, let's go.
Who once stole Christmas?
The Grinch.
Correct.
Sorry.
Oh, that wasn't even...
All right, next question.
Who helps Santa in making his gifts?
Wait, elves.
That is partially part of the answer.
And Mrs. Claus and reindeer.
Correct.
Whole.
Reindeer don't help make the gifts.
Who was the star of the Christmas movie Jingle All the Way?
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Correct.
That's past my realm of knowledge.
What is the first name of Scrooge, the principal character of the novel A Christmas Carol?
Ebenezer.
Touche.
Ebenezer.
Yes, correct.
Here's your bell with a husband who plays that.
All right. How many reindeer drive Santa Claus's sleigh if you count Rudolph?
Nine,
yes.
I held off on that because of Rudolph.
Who invented electric Christmas lights?
I got no clue.
Thomas Edison.
What year?
1922.
No.
How am I supposed to know the year?
It was Thomas Edison in 1880. But you still got it right, because okay. You said Thomas Edison. The legend of Santa Claus is associated with which saint or monk?
Saint Nicholas.
Correct.
Cool.
How many ghosts are there in A Christmas Carol?
Three.
Incorrect.
Four!
Correct.
Okay.
There are four.
Ha 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 ha.
R-O-N-G wrong. What was the name of the animated Christmas movie featuring Tom Hanks?
Polar Express. I almost broke that. I'm sorry.
Correct. It is the Polar Express.
I didn't know Tom Hanks was in
that. Which Christmas song holds the credit as the most selling Christmas single of all time?
Mariah Carey, All I Want for Christmas Is You.
No.
I didn't think so, but it's popular.
Is it Winter Wonderland?
No, it isn't. It is White Christmas.
Yeah.
Which company made the concept of Santa Claus popular worldwide?
Coca-Cola.
Correct.
Why do you know this?
I know too much.
It's
not important information, but I know it.
I've played this game before, I'm pretty sure.
Jimmy, take it away.
Who said, "Don't cry, I'll be back again someday"?
Frosty.
Correct.
Really?
I've been listening to a lot of music, Christmas music.
In the movie A Christmas Story, what was Santa's response to Ralphie's request for a BB gun for Christmas?
You'll shoot your eye out.
Correct. What child actor starred in the Christmas movie Home Alone?
Oh, shoot.
Macaulay Culkin?
Yes.
I never know how to pronounce his name, but I knew the kid.
Macaulay Culkin. That's his name.
Macaulay Culkin. Whatever.
What are two-thirds of the way through? We are two-thirds of the way through.
Oh.
The score is 3-10, Tori.
Yeah.
Now our final seven questions are a little tricky. I will give you a literal description of a Christmas song, title, and you have to name the song. For example, I would say, a long piece of thread that holds material that surrounds the foot together. The answer would be shoestring. Only my question for you describes the title of the Christmas song. The name, the same rules apply to using the buzzers. Here goes. Name the song. I witnessed with my own eyes my mother engage.
I saw mommy kissing Santa Claus. Oh.
Correct.
There we go.
Wow. Bestowing an emotion of great delight or happiness on the third.
Joy to the world?
Correct.
I don't know.
Apply ornamental decorative items to the house connective passageways.
Deck the halls.
Correct.
I
played this game last year and you're still winning.
My parents' mother was involved in an unexpected trampling incident.
Grandma got ran over by a reindeer.
Correct.
What's your favorite Christmas song?
That's yours?
Mm-hmm.
I can see that.
A complete absence of sound during the time from some...
Silent Night.
Correct. The only thing I desire to acquire on the 25th day of Christmas...
All I want for Christmas is you.
No.
No?
Can you finish the question, please?
I'll start over. The only thing I desire to acquire on the 25th day of December is a pair of processes attached to the forward section, my jaw, serving for the chewing of food.
All I want for Christmas is my two front teeth?
Correct. It is our sincerest desire for you to experience a December 25th full of cheerfulness.
We wish you a Merry Christmas.
Correct.
No.
All right. That's all the questions, and our holiday trivia challenge winner is Tori. Congratulations, Tori.
Good game, Maggie.
Good game to you, too.
Well, that does it for this edition of The Morning Show.
For the best TV of all, each and every day, keep it tuned right here for New Hanover County Schools TV on the Learning Network of the Cape Fear.
Have a great day.
And a wonderful week.